is studying scripture and teaching for everybody? This is a question I ask myself very often, and I think about it often because I'm very aware that the Bible says, don't let everyone be a teacher, for don't you know that teachers will be judged more strictly? Yet everybody wants to be a teacher nowadays. And when you go, for example, on Facebook, you see all these teachings, and they're often so unbiblical, and it is like people don't even worry about it. Now, it is not wrong to be, it is not bad to be wrong about something, but we should evolve, right? Because none of us know everything about everything or are correct 100% about everything. But it's a process. But it will cost you if you want to go into becoming a teacher. It's a process. So I'm going to go over some verses for those who are called to study and be teachers, because there is much more to it than most Christians think. And it's not easy, right? It has to be because you are led by the Spirit and not led by man. And of course, all Christians claim to be led by the Spirit of truth and not by man, but are they, right? So I'm gonna go over some pointers. And if this is not a video for everybody, but if you really have a zeal to study, and I know a few people who dedicate hours a day in studying, this might help them, right? Because you cannot become a teacher because you know a few verses here and there, right? Everything has to fit more and more, and it's a process, and you're going to be led more and more in all truth. So when I look at myself, the day that God came in my life, I felt Spirit change me. It was so drastically the change that I really gave up literally everything I had. I even gave up my home country. I went to England a few years, and that Spirit, that day that changed me so drastically, that's the Spirit I cling to. And I never clung to any man, or I accepted it for a while and then I found it was false, for example. And you have to be really, you have to be in the faith first, right? It's not that you first have to know and understand everything about everything before you can be saved. No, it's the Spirit by faith. And then this faith will result in a walk that leads you to all truth. But many people are, for example, don't have time to study the Bible. They have a very busy job. Some people maybe have an intellect that is different than others. So not everybody is called to do the same thing, but the most important thing is faith, right? The faith that changes you from the inside out. That's the most important thing. So don't think you have to understand everything about everything before you can be saved, right? So the first time I read the Bible, when after I was saved, I felt the Spirit inside of me. I never longed for the Bible or reading it. I thought it was ridiculous, and that day I just couldn't help myself. And I read the New Testament in a Dutch version. I didn't know anything about false translations. I just read it, and the general story I believed, and I thought it was awesome. And then I read the entire Bible through. But there were a lot of things I didn't understand. All these genealogies and all these things and the wars. I read it through, but it didn't really mean anything. But my faith was there. And that's what a lot of Christians, they have a Bible, and sometimes, very often, they don't have really time or a zeal to really go into depth. So they read a few verses at night, and it can be very comforting. It comforted me. But what happens after that? You go to listen to teachers, whether it is in church, you go to a church and you learn a doctrine, even though there are so many doctrines and ideas around, or you go to YouTube, and because you read the Bible and there are things you don't understand, so you click in YouTube your question, and then you see a sermon, and it is a sermon, right? And well, it resonates a little bit with you, and this is what it means. But a lot of these pastors and teachers, they go to a Bible school, and what do they learn in a Bible school? They learn a doctrine. You can go to a Calvinist Bible school and Trinitarian Bible school or Pentecostal Bible, all these different schools. So it also depends on what school they went to. So are these people guided by the Spirit of Truth, or are they just people who like to study a topic or a doctrine and learn to read it into the Bible? Because this is very often what happens. They teach you a concept and then they tell you, okay, this is this verse and this verse, and then you go to church with your marker and you mark these verses, and basically that's where many people stick to these few verses, and they make a whole doctrine around it, and it stays with them forever, right? So and what happens, these people go on Facebook, for example, and they start to post verses or memes, and these verses are often very ambiguous. And then I think, is this verse really saying what you think it says, or is it the doctrine that you have learned to read into this verse? So because very often there are contradictions, and if Christians see a contradiction that does not line up with what they believe, they tend to ignore these contradictions. So we shouldn't ignore contradictions. These contradictions are to make you reconsider what you believe, rather than explain them away or say it's a mystery or just to ignore them. How often do people read the Bible the whole life long and always skip over the parts that don't make sense to them, right? But these things should trigger you to look deeper, because everything has to fit. Nothing has to contradict itself. And then you have to not just listen to teachers and accept everything they say, also study and read yourself. Even the videos I make, you know, test what I say. You know, I'm not 100% right about everything, right? There are some things here and there I even still meditate about. But it's a process. You have to go deeper and deeper and deeper if that's your thing, right? But it's very, very dangerous to believe something without ever really studying the Bible and then make yourself into a teacher. That's a very dangerous thing, because teachers will be judged more strictly, right? Also, you have to be aware, and most Christians don't even know this, or they don't want to hear it, that our English translations are translated by translators, and they are all biased. They have a certain doctrine, and they have changed words and phrases here and there to make it seem that the doctrine is in the Bible. So what you have to do is first be aware of this, and then, for example, go to the Greek Septuagint. I think this is one of the most reliable sources we have, and there are people who literally translated the Greek Septuagint. It was written hundreds of years before Jesus, and this is where they started to translate. The Hebrews translated it into Greek, and so you have Bible tools on your screen. Look at certain words or look at some verses and go to the Hebrew and the Greek and compare and see if your English Bible translation really says what the original verses say. And then meditate about it. Meditate day and night. Sometimes when things don't fit, I can't stop thinking about it, meditating about it, and then I come to a point that I don't understand it, and I go to that chapter, and I keep going till it makes sense. And also look at parable verses. Many Christians think the Old Testament is done away with, we just read the New Testament, while the New Testament is a direct reference to the Old Testament. All these verses that created doctrines, they can be related to verses, quotations from the Old Testament. And then you see that often these verses don't mean at all what the pastor told you. It means what's referring to in the Old Testament. And therefore, many Christians, I see, for example, on Facebook, when you write something or you make a video, they immediately automatically contend with you. No, this is not true. rather than to listen what you say, because I'm not trying to deceive anybody, but and search yourself to see what I say is true. But many Christians automatically want to react. The cognitive dissonance is very strong, and even though the contradictions and it is a mystery, no, they want to contend for hours and hours. So you have to also be open, right? Not to teachers who tell you that the Bible is wrong and it is false and Jesus never existed. Don't listen to these teachers, right? But if someone gives you a deeper view or a different view than what the church has taught you, listen to it, search yourself, and it takes time. And I'm aware that not everyone has the time, is not blessed with the time to do this. But just reading a few verses at night and never finding out what the true language meant or said, or the Hebrew way of thinking, you will never get to the point that you get that your understanding increases. That's why many Christians, after decades, they still are at the level of church doctrine rather than to be able to discern, right? Isaiah said in 28:10, for precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a bit, there a bit. So it's a process, here a bit, there a bit, try to make it all fit, because you cannot trust men. But it is only if you allow the Spirit to guide you in all truth, right? You cannot go to a church and then fully trust men, right? They can be right about certain things, but they can also be wrong about certain things. And very often, when people find out a deeper understanding and they found out that the church teaches wrongly, they go to another church that teaches that same thing, but then they think they are right about all the other things too. Now, if you want to be a teacher, it's your responsibility to let the Spirit guide you, right? And again, there are not many people who are able to do this, whether it is through work or whatever, right? And then a very helpful tool is when you hear a new thing that doesn't line up with the church has taught you. For example, the Trinity. This is the first thing that came in my mind in England. I always started to ask questions and pastors, and they never had an answer, and you just have to accept it, and it is a mystery, and then they go to a few verses, try to make it fit, and it didn't make sense, and I studied so much, and now it makes sense. Now I realize that Jesus is the Messiah and the Son of the living God, without trying to make the Son into God himself. But, for example, when you hear something new, open your Bible and read the books, only looking for that one thing. Because if you just read the Bible as a story, you will never find out the deeper meanings. So you have to read, for example, the book of John, and you just highlight all the verses that talk about the thing you're searching for. And then you put them all together, you read them, you study them, you look at the Greek, what it really says, and then you often see things you never saw before. And then other doctrines too. Read the books and look at certain words. For example, Isaiah, when you just read it as a story, it doesn't make sense to most, right? Most people only know a few verses from Isaiah, but when you find out new things, look for these things one by one, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a bit, there a bit. This is a very practical way of studying, that you specifically look for certain things in Scripture. Not all things together in one passage, but look for certain words, phrases, right? Topics. That's very, very helpful. And then when you find new, deeper understanding, meditate on it day and night. There are things I don't understand yet, or that don't fully make sense yet, and I can't stop thinking about it. I can't find peace in it till I figure it out. And that gives me a zeal to read. Sometimes in the morning, I read 6 hours just to find something all day long, and that, after a while I have to stop because it's so much. But you have to really search, right? 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show yourself approved of God, a workman who needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And again, this takes a lot of zeal and a lot of time. And then also, you can look up for words. For example, the word hell. You see in our English Bibles, hell, 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 hell everywhere. Now you look at what they were really talking about. It can be grave, Gehenna, all these things. Well, you write in your Bible the true meaning. And so step by step, line upon line, you go into more and more depth and you find more and more things out. So there is a spirit of contention. And there are like 30, 40,000 different denominations and they all fight each other. But rather than to fight with each other all the time, listen to one another and see what the other say, if it's really true. And very often, the more you learn and you listen to preachers on YouTube, for example, who have thousands or millions of views, very often, very quickly, you find out what they say is just not true. But you can only come to the point if you really diligently seek. So just reading your Bible over and over again, your KJV or your NIV, which is filled with corruptions and mistranslations, you will never come to the point. And you should be very careful to just make memes which are just not biblical. And because it's such a wonderful search, and only a few really have the time to do this. But give it a chance, listen to them, and find some time. Very often people can watch movies, Netflix shows, but they still want to be contentious, while they also can use all these hours behind Netflix to go open your Bible and just start reading. Just reading, and not a verse here and there. Really, honestly, read. And when things don't match up, don't just skip over them. Come to the point that you want to understand. And therefore I make these videos. I don't want you to accept everything I say. I want you to look it up to see if I'm true. Be a Berean, right? And if you find error, you can tell me and I will look in it too, because I'm not 100% about everything, but it's a process. You have to keep on searching, right? God bless you.